Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We rejoice today, don't we? We rejoice the gift of our Lord and Savior. So wherever Christ's name is known, the festivities have begun this day, and the bells are ringing throughout the world, and there is dancing going on and rejoicing, and everybody singing and praying, those who believe in our Christ, the Son of the living God. I'm rejoicing in the gift that God over 2,000 years ago gave his Son, Jesus Christ, as a gift. Not just once, but a gift that keeps on giving and keeps on living in our lives. The gift of Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. So we join our voices down through the years. We join our voices with all those who have proclaimed him Lord and God, who have sung praises to him. And so we're a ragtag army, aren't we? A ragtag chorus of moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas and administrators and musicians and teachers and homemakers and aunts and uncles and sales clerks. We're computer techies, social workers. We're all here as a ragtag chorus proclaiming our God as Lord and Savior, as Christians together. This is a day where our voices are raised throughout the world and no one can stifle our voice. And we're all rejoicing in God who so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that all those who believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God coming down, God, divinity, taking on the human form, coming down into the manger, into the smelly animal stall to be born. God with knuckles and knees and toes and eyelashes, giving us himself, giving himself into the world. As 2 Corinthians says, and I just love this scripture at this time of year, God gave his indescribable gift. Thanks be to God for God's indescribable gift, says 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And so this is the beginning of God's salvation plan, the hope for the world, a world that was living in darkness, a world that had not heard God's voice for 400 years, a world that had no prophet speaking for 400 years. The world was dark, and God said, this is the time, and he came into the world for all time and for all generations. Unto you, the angel announces, for unto you a Savior is born. Unto you and me, a Savior is born. And so how amazing is that sentence alone, that proclamation alone? Unto you and me, unto you. Not someone else down the road, not someone else at Five Corners Methodist Church, not someone else down at the gas station, not someone else in Manhattan, not someone else in Iowa or Michigan, but to you and to me. Excuse me. Unto you a Savior is born. Well, I want to share a story with you. Some of you may know this from being parents yourselves, but there were three trees on a hillside in a wooded area, and they were discussing their hopes and their dreams for themselves. And the first one said, someday, this first tree said, someday I hope to be a treasure chest. Gotta check the time, because you know me, I'll go off somewhere. Someday I hope to be a treasure chest, and then I would be filled with gold and silver and precious gems, and people would be so impressed with me, and I could be decorated outside with wood carvings, and everyone would see my beauty. The second tree said, someday I would like to be a mighty ship. I know that my tree and my branches are strong, and then if I become a mighty ship, I will take kings and queens across the waters and sail to all four corners of the world. And everyone will feel safe in my home because my wood is strong. Well, the third tree said, I want to grow to be the tallest and the straightest tree in the forest. People will see me on top of the hillside, and they will look up and see my branches, and they will think about heaven, and they will think about God, and how close to them I am, and that I am reaching to the heavens. And I will be the greatest tree of all time, and people will always remember me. Well, after a few years of praying, their dreams would come true, or not, you decide. They would come true. A group of woodsmen, three woodsmen, came upon these trees. And when they came upon these trees, the first woodman said to the first tree, to one another about the first tree, "This tree looks like a strong tree. I could cut it down and I will sell it to the carpenter. And the carpenter can use it for something wonderful." And so the first woodsman began cutting down the tree. And then the second woodsman went to the second tree. And he knew, and he looked at the tree and he said, "You know, I could sell this wood to a shipyard." And that made the tree very happy, of course. And then the shipyard could build from this strong and beautiful wood. And so the woodsman cut down the tree. And then the third woodsman went to the third tree and he looked at the tree, and the tree became frightened. Because if he were to be cut down, he would not continue to grow and stretch to the heavens and be seen by all people as a mighty tree. And so his dream was in jeopardy. But the woodsman, he decided that he really didn't need anything special from this tree and its wood, but he decided he would cut it down anyway. And so he did. And so years went on, and many years went on, and the first tree was crafted into a feeding box for animals. This had not been the dream of the first tree. The second tree was cut down. That was cut down. It was made into a small fishing boat. His dreams of being a mighty ship and carrying kings and queens across the waters, that dream was dashed. The third tree that was cut down into large pieces was just left off to the side, and in the dark, and was laid there for many years. Well, the years went by, and the trees forgot about their own dreams and what they wanted for themselves. And then one day, a man and a woman came to the barn. And she gave birth, and they placed the baby that day in the hay, in the feeding trough that had been built out of the first tree. And then the man wished that he could have a crib for his baby to make that manger. The tree could feel the importance of the job that he was doing, the importance of this event, and that this event held greater treasure than he could have hoped for or imagined. Years later, a group of men got together in a fishing boat made from the second tree. And one of them was tired and went to sleep. And when they were out on the water, the seas got rough and the winds blew and the storm arose. And the tree didn't think it was going to be strong enough to hold these people in the boat and keep them safe. But the man awoke, a sleeping man. And he stood up and he said, "Peace." And the storm quieted down. At this time, the tree knew that it had done an important job. And and that it had made possible for God to perform a miracle, because Jesus was the one that had calmed the water. Excuse me. Finally, someone came and got the third tree. The third tree was in pieces, and it was carried through the streets as the people mocked the man carrying the cross. And when they came to stop, the man was nailed to this tree and raised in the air to die at the top of a hill. When Sunday came, the tree came to realize that it was strong enough to stand at the top of the hill and hold the man being crucified. Christ Jesus had died on that tree. You see, today is the beginning of God's salvation plan. We don't know God's plan. We don't know the plan for our lives. We don't know what God has in mind for us. But God will use us in many and various ways. God will use us to proclaim his message of hope and love to a darkened world. This is Christmas, and our Christmas tree that we have right here will be cut down and made into a cross for Lent, and then decorated with flowers for Easter to remind us of the entire salvation story. You see, this story of the birth of Christ would be just that, a story. A nice and simple and loving story to make our celebrations feel good. But it's not about feeling. It's about knowing and trusting that God is who he says he is. The one born in a manger, the one to give his life on the cross. The truth is stunning. The truth of Christmas is a stunning story. The beginning of God's salvation plan. Christ has come, Christ has died, and Christ will come again. That's the joy of today. Life for you and me. God so loved the world that he gave himself into the world. The hands of God, the hands that drew into the dust of the earth, the rivers and the streams, the hands that placed into its course the planets, the hands that placed into the heavens the stars, the hands that created the mountains, the hands that fashioned us people out of the dust of the earth. Those same hands reached down and placed his son in the manger of Bethlehem. And those same hands are the hands that opened wide on a cross and received the nail blows. And those same hands are the ones that embrace us in our time of struggle and difficulty. Those same hands come together and applaud and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Take possession of the kingdom prepared for you." Those hands were once tiny little hands being cuddled and coddled and stroked by a 13-year-old teenager, frightened teenager, in an animal barn, animal stall, in the little town of Bethlehem. And these hands are the hands of our Savior and our Lord. Enjoy him. Do not miss the joy of Jesus today. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
O Lord, you shall reign forever and ever. You, a tiny baby in the manger of Bethlehem, grew to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the mighty God and Prince of Peace. We say thank you, Lord. And as we celebrate today, we remember this great gift. You broke through time and history. You became and took on our human form. You knew our troubles and our pain and our struggles. And then you took it all upon you, our sin, the sin of the whole world, and you went to the cross. We say thank you, Lord, and we say alleluia. We lift our voices in praise and thanksgiving with the angels. We join in the travels of the shepherd as they ran to Bethlehem to see this thing that they had been told about. And when they saw it, they saw the birth of a baby, and not just any baby. And they went and proclaimed what they had seen and heard, and some believed and some didn't. Well, down through the ages, Lord, the same thing is true. Some believe, some don't. And so today, as we celebrate and remember who you are and what you are about and what you have done for us, we rejoice. We lift our voices with all those who have gone before us. We say thank you, Lord, and we call upon your name. Heavenly Father, in this Christmas morning, grace awakened, and we say thank you for that grace. We say thank you, Lord, that light has broken through the darkness of this world. May that light penetrate our hearts. May we be reminded continually of the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, as the glories of heaven, heavenly hosts sang your praises once, 2,000 years ago, down through the years, we who believe in you and believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, we join our voices as a ragtag chorus of Christians, Christ ones, your children, proclaiming you as God and Lord. Let the heavenly hosts and our voices ring and echo in this church, this day and always, as we worship you and praise you. We open ourselves up to you, Lord, and to your Holy Spirit that inspires our lives and the meaning and purpose of our living, which is to honor you and bring you glory. As we celebrate your birth, we ask that you would instill in us a profound sense of your abiding presence, that you are Emmanuel, God with us. Help us to take into our hearts the wonder of your love, so that we might walk in your ways to your glory. Heavenly Father, we thank you for a life that has been changed because of you and your Son, Jesus Christ. Continue to change us, to bring out the very best in us to your glory. Heavenly Father, there are so many who do not know you. Use us to be a beacon of hope and light, to proclaim your message that unto you a Savior is born. There is Emmanuel, God with us. Heavenly Father, we pray to you with our deepest thanks and praise. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.